good songs about good hearts. Also a lot of kind of jokes. Hitler, I think probably you also talk a lot when you sit outside of it. Hitler was very much afraid of Burkhardt, something like that. These albums, it's nothing like that. Because it was a kind of conspiracy theory that you are very much acquainted with. Outside, Burkhardt's history is exaggerated as one of the most important and one of the most brave soldiers, one of the most dedicated soldiers, one of the most faithful soldiers, all this kind of thing. But inside the pain you actually go into, it's one of the most measurable history which is totally clouded, totally hidden, and totally not known, because British always want to create a kind of sense outside that they have done very good treatment to them and these are the very good people in the world. So it is their loyalty that this is actually appreciating. But I always say that without any hesitation, whatever might be the treaty prepared in 1947, there is no question that Burkhardt are Muslim soldiers. So that's my stand. And I also had a chance to present in the House of Commons almost 10 years before I said the same thing, that this is one of the most gruesome exploitation of some citizens by other countries. So this is not exactly what we see outside. So actually, if you really want to listen songs about Burkhardt, it is nice to have those very pathetic, very miserable, and very exploitative situations to reflect in songs. So I have stopped after talking about all these good things about Burkhardt. So scene is completely different. It is really a very big issue and it takes very long time. So it's not possible for me to cover many aspects. So I will just quickly run to you. My objective would be to introduce you on certain very important issues. Hopefully in the days to come you will undertake research and start exploring some different venues, some different aspects of this problem. I will slightly touch upon later on the tripartite agreement. There is a treaty between three countries, India, Nepal, and Belize, the UK. That time when this treaty was signed, tripartite treaty, India still was not independent. So India had signed with the capacity of the dominant government of India. So what that status is in international law, I don't know. There is no country as a subject in international law which is called dominant government of India. That means India still was not free. And why that India was included within it is not known. But it has a big stigma. It's a serious stigma in Nepal's sovereignty. I will be discussing a little bit in the last part. But I will just go a couple of things in a zigzag way, okay? I will talk a little bit the later part, and again I will go to the back part, and then I will do it. So my intention is to give you a kind of reflection. Some very important issues like Burkhardt are Nepalese, and they are sold and battered. If the Nepalese rupees is not convertible currency, Nepalese bodies have long been valued currencies in the other market, means international market. This is what many days change. A Canadian researcher on Burkhardt who had helped me in building equality campaign for Burkhardt. So she worked with me a couple of years to do much more research, to document it. So this is what she has written, a very good article. So if your currency is useless, but you're very much important, like any one of you, if not in British, but in India, you can be recruited as Burkhardt. So we have Indian Burkhardt and the British Burkhardt. I guess that you understand this much. Burkhardt valiantly sacrificed in the First and Second World Wars for defeating Japan and Germany, but they were discriminated by the British government in many aspects of their service. The history of bravery is exaggerated, whereas their pains are overshadowed. The British has always projected Gurkhas as valiant. The reason is to suppress or hide the discrimination and plight they have been subjected to. I already gave you a lot of reflection. They have always been mobilized in the front lines, and so that the number of casualties in Gurkhas Brigade was explicably greater to those units of the British Army. 35% of the British soldiers died in the First World War. American War Office History Archives has mentioned about it. Evidently, based on given figure of 150,000 Gurkha soldiers recruited and mobilized in the First World War, the number of those killed exceeds 50,000 men. Unfortunately, these deaths are never accounted for. The number is, however, said to be over 2,000. This is the First World War situation. The official record is 150, but there was a lot of practice going to Gorakhpur and many other parts of India and get enlisted, because Nepalese had often been to visit these parts for carrying salt and other commodities. So whenever British saw these young people coming across the border, they enticed and they recruited. But they were not listed here. So authentic listing, authentic number is from the British record is not found, because many of them were not enlisted as Gurkhas, but they were enlisted as Indian citizens. For example, those who were enlisted and recruited in Assam, they just were Indian, that's all. Interesting history. When I was dealing with this moment, I was in Bhutol and I found a very old man. He and his son had gone to buy salt in Gorakhpur. Two British recruiters saw it, and they came, and then they started enticing them. They were asking that we will give you good money if you give your son. He was 14 years. And the father unfortunately said that, okay, no, I'm not going to give my son to be British Army. But if you recruit myself, okay, I'm like, he did it because they will not. Then they asked him, like, how old you are? He said that I'm 45 years old. They said that, okay, fine, both of you. Both of them were enlisted and recruited. So boys' age was increased to 19, and father's age was reduced to 35. So both were enlisted, trained, and they were placed in Egypt front line. It was a rigorous war. The son was the commander, the father was the sepoy. Okay, and then he said that, how did you feel fighting with your son? He said that probably he was not much more caring about me because I was a father, but he was my only son. So I always looked at him whether he is still alive or not. So I was putting myself in a danger because I was just doing like that, is son still alive or not? Unfortunately, the son died in the same war. The father survived and came. And he was living in Bhutol, in slum area, that means the Sukumbasi area. So still, there's a lot of kind of cases in there. So it's not a British failure, it's a failure of citizens like you and me. Because we always think of good. Many of you, after international relations class, maybe if we happen to go to America, we will see each other over there, yes? Many of you will be there. So that's the kind of situation the country is facing. Youths were drained during wars. During two world wars, eligible Nepalese youths have been totally drained. In the beginning, Rana's declined to recognize the practice of recruitment. Jang Bahadur actually issued a notice that those who had gone to British should not be allowed to come back in Nepal. Even if they come back somehow, they should be in the border, or rituals should be carried out. That is called Patiya. Do you know what is that? Patiya, it's something like sprinkling gold water and then doing some rituals and then get you in. So that was the practice. Tragedy was like Jang Bahadur was killed, Jang Bahadur died, and you say Samsher Rana's took over. Entire Jangabadur's family was killed, set back, probably you have said. Then Veer Samsher came. It was for the British very good occasion to get approval of the government of Nepal for official recruitment kind of thing. So British probably secretly proposed to the in this coup d'etat to the Samsher Rana's. And Samsher Rana's probably promised that, okay, we will allow you to recruit Gurkhas if you support us. So after this discussion, after a few weeks, the approval of the Viceroy from Delhi came to Kathmandu, and this government installed by the coup d'etat was recognized by the British. So after that, this system of Patia ended. And though still there was not a written permission issued, but people started going in flocks to go to India for the recruitment. And there was an official kind of notice, not through some kind of agreement, but there was a shun of issues by successor of Jangabahadur Rana to Taludars and Jamindar that if they catch one youth boy, they would get some benefit. So all Jamindars and Taludars were hunting for these good boys like we hunt, like the we hunt for some animals in the forest, okay? Hunting animal is now prohibited, but still hunting human being in Nepal is not prohibited. So Indian and British camps in Dharan, Butul, they are still hunting Nepalese youth. So you cannot hunt, you cannot kill monkeys in the forest, but you can hunt Nepalese citizens. So this is what country Nepal is like. So in 1940s, the recruitment was carried out in such a massive sweep that the additional demand of the British in 1994 for 2,000 recruits, it's not 94, 49, recruits was made only after hunting every nook and corner of the country. Judha Samsher's letters to British Viceroy is abhorrent and abominable. By this time, there was still not treaty to formalize the recruitment, but it was some kind of customary practice already emerged. So huge number of people already had been recruited. In Second World War, almost huge number of Gurkhas were exterminated in the war. So there were some fallouts still, even in 1949. So there was a request from the Viceroy from India to Judha Samsher that we want more people, please. So the letter I will read you out later on. It said that you're the most best friend of Nepal in the world. So though there is not a single eligible man in Nepal left, but still, please tell your recruiters to go very interior parts of the country, maybe you find some people. So hunting across the country in 1949, there were 12,000 eligible youths were explored, and they were also sent to British Army. Why this watch? Why Rana's were there so much interested? Indian rupees 10 lakhs every year as a royalty. So British gave 10 lakhs Indian rupees to Ranaj. So why these big buildings in Kathmandu today is the blood of these people who died in the war. Shinga Darbar, all these Darbar and all, these are the costs, like 10 lakhs Indian currency of that time. This is called company sometime to, just excuse me for 2 minutes, okay? To git aancha ni company, paisa ko git, real chadera jane company, that's what, okay? It was huge money actually. So for allowing the unrestricted recruitment, they had this allowance. Chandra Shamsher banned non-military employment of Nepalese for making supply for Gurkha's regiment on an epic. So this time, until this time, some people still visited Nepal, India, They went to work in Kikaris, in Darjeeling, and Assam, and other part. But since British complained that your government is allowing people to go to India to work for some other business, we are failing to get good number of youths. So to facilitate the process that British would get good people, so Chandra Samse issued a summer that said that no Nepalese in India should be recruited for non-military purpose. That means everybody would be forced to go to the military. This was also a very shocking kind of exploitation. Ranas were culprits. That's my conclusion. That's the hypothesis that I've been working with. Fortunately, after a long time, my connections with Gorkha movement was disconnected, but for last couple of weeks again, I am connected with it, and we are now building this case as a very big international issue. We're probably taking to the British court, and also if it is possible to European Human Rights Courts, and probably the joint meeting of the government and everything, because this history should come out is what is my working right now. Ranas asked British officials to prohibit Gurkhas writing letters to families, because a lot of information was communicated from India to the families here. For two reasons, Ranas wrote letter to the British government not to allow their soldiers, the Gurkhas, to write back to Nepal. For one reason, probably they were afraid that they would write back to their families, like how Indian independence movement was brewing up in India, so Nepalese would learn about that, one reason. Another reason, if they write this kind of bad story, newcomer, the new batch of people would desist going to recruitment. So for these two reasons. And actually, British banned Gurkhas to write letters to their families for a long time. When British officials once said, they were made so foolish and so stupid, like they were not given position over Subedar, that is surgeon, that is some little bit of that is head constable kind of thing. Okay, so one gentleman said me how stupid and foolish they were made in British Army. Was like when British officers once said, "See what a buffalo is flying in the sky." Okay, did you get the point? Okay. What was the answer of the Gurkhas? Was like, "Yes, sir, buffalo is flying in the sky." So, if this critical mind was not destroyed, Gurkhas would ask when they were fighting in Egypt, when they were fighting in Argentina, when they were fighting in Germany, they were fighting in Malaysia, they were fighting in every nook and corner, they would ask the British soldiers who these are, who we are fighting. So, one instructions, war memo, issue to the Gurkhas with that, when you fight, just look and see the command of your white officers, do not ask anything, just fight. Okay, many people which Gurkha killed in the war did not know who these people were who killed, Italian or Libyan or nobody. Okay, so when last war Gurkha had port in Argentina, after meet travel in the sea, Gurkhas fell vomiting, okay? They got seasickness. So they said that, "No, we will walk, but we will not go in the sea, okay? We are feeling very vomiting, we are feeling dizzy." So Gurkhas requested the British commander to get them off and bring them to shore, but that was not, this land was very difficult, mass land, and many would probably die. So they said that a lot of danger is there, you would die. A lot of pythons and other. They said that, okay, instead of we sail in the sea, we will walk. So British went to another way. Therefore, Gurkhas were down, Argentinian were on the hilltop, and British already escaped by the ship, so they would not die. So had Argentinian open fire, I think almost 2,000 Gurkhas would be massacred. But what the British immediately did was like they were helicopters throwing pamphlets. And this pamphlet, if you want to see it, at least I have one copy with me right now. What this pamphlet wrote was like, these Gurkhas are cannibals. They practice cannibal. They kill enemies. And the first thing they do is like, they chop into pieces and they do the barbecue. And after eating, they find dangerous. So most of the Argentinian soldiers fled because they knew that there's Gurkhas. Otherwise, they would make a barbecue. So that's that was the fate. That was the good thing British did. Nepalese could not die. So Argentinian did not open the fire. So that's how they escaped. So these were Metsophilis. And British always condemned them as they are the blood-sucking people. They are the armed race. They eat human flesh. They just know to kill, but they don't know anything else. So these are not perfectly developed human beings. They are just children of chimpanzees or something like that. Therefore, they don't have mind. Was a kind of information always disseminated among the enemies British fought with. The British authorities claim that they have done great many things to community of ex-servicemen and their children through Gurkha's welfare scheme. However, the claim is not true. There are some very pathetic information. If you open this article of mine, A Tradition of Bartering and Selling Nepalese Youth, you find in the website, okay, you can read it. But let me very slightly give two instances. One, you have Pakribas, you have Lumley, and you have road from Dharan to Dhankuta that is often believed to be constructed with the British help. No, that's not true. It's almost 6,000-7,000 Gurkhas were held by Zahmus in 1947 as prisoners of war. After negotiation, Japanese had to compensate $125 for one army they held as prisoners of war for almost 6 or 7 months. So it was a huge money. Actually, these prisoners of war were supposed to get personally according to international law. But this money was collected by the British and it was put into a hidden bank account in London. This was a government account, but this was not exposed. So that was the money British later on in the name of the British aid supplied to government of Nepal. So Pakribas and Lumley were constructed out of that. And also the road constructed from Dhankuta to Dharan to Dhankuta was under this. Still there was a huge money during referendum time in Panchayat. It is informed to us that British government somehow leaked this information to the government of Nepal that time, Panchayat. But they also looking for some favor of the government. So probably that time, king was in a problem and Panchayat was in a problem. So they were able to negotiate secretly anything with the British government. For the lieu of that, I have heard seeing some British commander to me in the time of my engagement, that it's 55 crore rupees was, Nepalese rupees was given to Surya Bahadur Thapa to make the Panchayat wing. So that money was also these people's money. Okay, so actually British has got, I mean, Gurkhas have got nothing, but there is a huge money. So this is another scandal. So the British government is persistently denying equalizing the pension and all the benefits of Gurkha. In contravention to the Convention of European Human Rights and Freedoms, International Bill of Human Rights, and the British Race Relations Act, the British government is paying more than 20 times less pension to the Gurkhas than their British counterparts. So there is a law in UK called Race Relations Act. According to the Race Relations Act, there are categories defined, and these categories have been defined like colonial service in the past, the Queen's servant, Queen's service. And in the Queen's service, it is also the Gurkha Brigade. That means all employees within the boundary of Queen's service should be treated on equal footing. And in the annex, we each, the man or woman, in the Queen's service is also Gurkha Brigade. Then the question is like, why 24 pound pension to British, Nepalese, and 324 pound to British? Is a basic issue that I raise. 24-pound pension given to Nepalese, okay, and 324-pound to the British, okay. So now, after a long moment, that has been raised to 124-pound, but it's still discrimination persists, it's still discrimination continues. So British are paid one kind of pension and Hindus have been paid another kind. Now British is quite actively engaged, After 1996, the pension is equal to those who have been recruited and the salary is also made equal to them. But vast number of people, still about 34,000 or 40,000 who did not enter British Army in 1996 are there. So they get discriminated. So what is the reason is like British is engaged so much actively in negotiation? It's like another 10 years negotiation, most of these people will die. So that's a strategy. So this is an inhuman kind of strategy British have been applying, and many Nepalese here, we have been quite supporting there because they have given a very good good scholarship to our children in Oxford and Cambridge. Sachib children go for that, and professors children go for that. Who these Gurkhas are? These are poor folk. So policies is very difficult. Actually, it was terribly difficult. I used to have threats that time from Nepalese to support Gurkhas, even politicians. They used to discuss in the political party's central committee that why this man is instigating these people, kind of thing. But I was right because this was discrimination. Good thing was like Sydney Kentridge, the lawyer of Nelson Mandela, used to happen somehow, my friend. So I communicated a lot with him. Finally, with his help, we found two very good lawyers in the UK. Geoffrey Weinman and C.K. Allen. So I went to London and we discussed. It was very difficult for me also to convince them this discrimination. But after a weeks long presentation, these lawyers convinced. So it was because of the Sydney's support with his name of the Nelson Mandela's lawyer in UK and all. So we brought this issue in House of Commons. We discussed with the Liberal parties and Liberal parties leader. So finally this issue went to the House of Commons, and then only British government realized that there is a discrimination. So British started realizing that this is a discrimination, but still Nepalese government was threatening me. Why do you do it? Okay, it's a kind of thing. So our government are very nationalist actually. 15 years of retirement for Gurkhas, it's a rule, okay? Gurkhas retire at 15 years, whereas British retired at 22 years. So what is their justification is that you retire in 15 and British retire in 22. So you should get 24 and then British should get 324. Okay, so final settlement we did was like, let's go to the proportionate idea. If 22 is 324, okay, reduce it and make 15. So might be it would be 250, but how it comes that it is 24 for the Nepalese? So still they are not ready to negotiate. So right now it is 800% higher gratuity and pension for the British, where it's 800% less to the Nepalese. Now let me show you one very interesting. So I have a lot of things to tell you, but I don't have time. So sometime we can discuss again. Like in 1952, 17,000 Gurkhas were mobilized in Malaysia. So it is called emergency period in Malaysia because communist insurgents, communist guerrillas started attacking, and almost they had taken the jungle parts of Malaysia. So this is one very interesting war in the world. I think we should let people know in the world, probably they would make a very good cinema, okay? Especially Americans and all that. It is a contract war. Malaysian government issued support for the support to defend government of Malaysia against communists, and British tendered for it. Okay, and British got this tender to fight against communists. So fight between communist and Malaysian government, but who was fighting? British. And who it was engaging? Gurkhas. Okay, so it's very interesting. It was 400 ringgit 400 ringgit means it was almost the same pound rate at that time. So each soldier was charged 400 to the Malaysian government. So Malaysian government paid almost 26,000 British soldiers with the rate of 400. Out of them, 17,000 were Gurkhas. And how much soldiers the Nepalese were given? 82. So how much British won from one soldiers? Can you calculate? I'm very poor. Okay, I'm very poor. I don't know how it becomes. I even cannot imagine this money. If this money comes to Nepal, Nepal will be suicidal. So it is not Gurkhas only defending British, but Gurkhas are very active source of owning part. British 17 years, almost 15, 16 years, 17,000 people with the rate of almost 400, 318 ringgit for 17 years, how big money was accumulated. So that was what I talked in, exactly I presented, and this is a fact. I talked in the House of Commons that we are demanding this money back. Then one of the Tory members in House of Commons said that then British would be bankrupt. That is your problem. It's not my problem. Because this cost that I've been demanding is for the bloc. Sure, whether you become bankrupt or not is not my concern, but we should get the money. So this is what is the issue. But after I raised this issue, what happened was like British were very active, and then all of a sudden, the Gurkha movement's people, some of these leaders of the Gesho people themselves were purchased by the British embassy. And then one fine morning we were given a letter by that organization that we are very much thankful for your service up to now, but onwards now your service, if we need we will call you, but thank you very much for this service. So we were ejected out of the moment, and it is almost 10 years, everything is collapsed. But now they understand again, and then a couple of months negotiation I agreed to work for them again. So we have started again working for them. So I don't know when British will give another chunk of money for this, and then we will be getting a letter that your service is no longer required. So that's a kind of thing. So it is position of battalion of Gurkha Reserve Unit out of retired Gurkha soldiers in Brunei. It is another very interesting thing. In 1960, when 11,000 were disbanded, redundant, but none of them already had 15 years. They didn't want to give a single pension to them. So they came back. 6,000 disappeared. Either killed in jungle or they were left. Now we know that there are a couple of villages they have been living over there. They forgot to speak Nepalese. They married Malayan, and they still are Nepalese, but they could not find the way to come out of jungle. So British even did not inform the government of Nepal. Neither government of Nepal asked for what about the 600, 6,000. So they were left in the jungle, they are still there. And out of these others, 11,000 redundant and 2,500 were taken to Hong Kong. So that was the minimum base recruitment. And rest of the camp, they were given just £300 to come back, and they were given very nice gift, tera hath se to kapda. So white cloth, shroud, you can say, when they die, they would be wrapped up. So 13 feet white cotton and £300 come back, fighting for the British. So sometime, are we born to fight for British? Where there was 33 crores gods in the past that we worship? So this was the biggest failure of Nepalese army too. We have a general, yes? Hopefully he will do the more research. It is one of the biggest failure of the Nepalese military too. Their brothers have been dying that way, but they still are not looking for it. It's the biggest failure of the government. It's the biggest failure of the political parties. And it is biggest failure of both Khadda Kesi and Yuvraj Singh. Because we are not good cats. I am bound in Chhetri. And universities have been written by all these kind of people. And most of you are also bound Chhetri. So this story will not be your story. Make this story your story, please. This is the biggest issue of human rights violation in the world. If we make a voice for them, I think we will save these people. So why don't they ask for ethnic state? We have been deserting them. We have been misutilizing, misappropriating their shirts. So why don't? Nobody is there to look after them. So this is the issue. So anyway, in 1947, tripartite agreement was conducted between Nepal, Britain, and Nepal Dominion government. Lies. I don't have too much to explain now. The British government has apparently ignored or truth that the Gurkhas are citizens of an independent sovereign country. It is against international law to recruit foreign nationals, so they are called Gurkhas. They are not called. So what is Gurkha is mysterious. Okay, Gurkhas are with kukuri. Gurkhas are cannibals. Gurkha chop people and barbecue. All these kind of things. Okay. And when there was a war in Brunei after Malaysia in 1968, Gurkhas were sent inside Indonesia, and Indonesians were slaughtered. A lot of people were killed because they were asked to kill them, whoever, pregnant woman, men, and anyone. So Gurkhas killed a lot of people. Very interestingly, what happened after that, a couple of Gurkhas were captured in Malaysia, in Indonesia. They were chopped up their heads, and then in a bamboo, they marched in Jakarta. So it's my advice, when you go to Indonesia, never say that I am Gurkha. The chance of you being killed is there. Say that Nepalese. And if they ask that, Gurkha and Nepal, oh, I don't know Gurkha, but probably there's some part in India, but not Nepalese. You will survive, otherwise you will be killed. So it's a hatred they have in Indonesia again, because this hatred was intentionally created by British. The British government, referring to troops of Great Commission, had provided 7,000 died and 10,068 wounded in the Second World War. So this is the record given to them. 35% casualties, 400,000 people used. What the British says is like only 7,000 people died and 10,068. Then where did these people go? Where are these Gurkhas? Are these informal people underneath the sea, or they are living in the sky? Nobody is looking for them. Not the government, not the British government. Actually, the lowest rate of their casualty is 35% British. And Gurkhas are always in the front line. Means, it is higher to the white officers and white soldiers. That means it might be probably 45 or 50%. Whereas for Russians, it was 84%. For France, it was 74, 72% casualties that time. So how Gurkha could be saved? Neither they knew which part of the world they were fighting, nor they were new. They were knowing that who they were fighting. So we guess that almost 200,000 people were died. So this record is record where these people who died in the hospital, and then they were to be buried down. And according to the culture of British, before they were buried, they needed this the coffin, okay? So this office is office to give coffin. So probably they issued 7,000 coffins. So therefore there is a record, that's all. And this 10,068 is the number who were hospitalized, okay? So this is another very big problem. This figure simply cannot be true. The total number of Gurkha soldiers mobilized during the Second World War exceeded 200,000 youths. That time Nepal's population was 8.7 million approximately. And four eligible male population. Out of all four eligible male, one was in the British Army. So how many soldiers died in the war is still unanswered question. Neither the government of Nepal nor UK has given or made honest attempts to collect the true figures, and maybe it would be a big service if you get involved yourself doing research and then start compiling this figure. I mean, it would be the biggest service you ever make to the government of Nepal or to this nation. So let me now go a little bit back how it happened, how Gurkha Brigade was created. In Johnny Gurkha, Eddie Smith writes, the fire-eating Prime Minister of Nepal, Bhimsen Thapa, was no friend of the British. It's what's very important. So the war, one of the causes of the war, according to Johnny Gurkha, this book is very good book you can read. It's comparatively fair. I mean, though this guy is a British, but he has brought a lot of information. The small fort of Bhurtpore was workmen. An English desisted from attempt to conquer it. Our hills are formed by the hands of gods and are impenetrable. Bhimsen Thapa, it was a historical mistake to be so offensive. Had we been able to postpone the war somehow, I think Nepal would still be remain. So it was the war offensive euphoria of Prime Minister Bhimsen Thapa actually created a division in among Amar Singh. And then Amar Singh said that you still are a child, you need not teach me the war strategy. It is better, let's postpone the war, I mean delay the war. We prepare ourselves first because we have only 12,000 army and we do not have very strong arms. Let's prepare, I mean, British are very clever, we should be clever. And then Bhimsen Thapa said that, uncle, you're very old now. Probably you have started fearing of war, so you can take rest. So that's how then Amar Singh Thapa said that, okay, I still will fight. I am for this country. So you need not talk like that, but give me the command wherever I will go. So he was given 6,000 army and he left for west. That was the reason when he was badly defeated in the war. Amar Singh Thapa was not killed. Actually, he was captured by the British force. And it is also heard that he was released by them as a honor that he was a gallantry, his gallantry of war. It is said that he should not be captured and put into war. Put into prison, so he was released. But then he didn't come back because his last statement somehow we are exploring that he do not want to go back and show his this ugly face to the king where he had been defeated in the war. So that's what. Okay, British had two strategies: defeat Nepal and drain its youths to reorganize against the British colony. They began to attack. Why they begin to attack? There are economic reasons, Tibet, Lhasa, and one very interesting thing probably would be very much interesting for Professor Casey. Silk Road. In 640 or something like that, the place called Khotan, it is also in our language called Khotan. Okay, Khotan used to be a triangular adjacent place of India, China, and Central Asia connections after Afghanistan. So Muslim, militant Muslim after Iran captured this place, and then they stopped this place to be more origin or the engine or the beginning point of Silk Road. So Ming Dynasty wrote a letter to Xuanzang Gompo in Lhasa to talk to Nepal to open Kerung that time. But that time, in Nepal, there was a young king, and who was being guided by was Abhira chief, that was a Shudra chief. So untouchability was not practiced in Nepal until that time. Okay, so he deposed Basant Dev, and Basant Dev's young son was put into throne, and that's because Narendra Dev and Basant Dev fled to Lhasa. Basant Dev died over here, but Narendra Dev was still for a long time. He was 30 years, and Ming Dynasty sent a group of entourage of 36 people to go to Magad and discuss with Indian king to develop a spiritual relation between China and India. But these people were stopped at Kerung because the present king and Abhira chieftain that time was against Lhasa and China because they had given refuge to Narendra Dev. So it was the reason like Narendra Dev was supported by Xuanzang Gompo's army. They came to Nepal, they installed him as a king, and then these 36 people later on came to Nepal. Okay. So after this, Kerung was the only Silk Road connecting point. So that was a route to go to Patna, from Patna to west to the Afghanistan and Iran. So for a long time, Kerung, Kathmandu, Patna used as a very important Silk Road connection. But you know, what is big problem with the Chinese that we have to raise issues like, China never see India, Nepal. Neither India sees Nepal. What is tragedy I find is like, when Indians look to north, they only see China, they don't see Nepal. Or they see China in Nepal. And what is the problem of Chinese is that when they see south, they only see India, they don't see Nepal. So every this record has been discussed as something like India, okay? Buddhabhadra was the first people in the 3rd century to go to Yunnan and was the first man to build the Shaolin temple over there. But the Chinese say that he was an Indian priest. So we are not demanding. I mean, what I say is like, next time when Chinese start coming, that we have to start this wedding issue. How can you convert a Nepalese man into Indian priest or something like that? So this is very important. So what I mean here is like, that was very important for British. So Kathmandu was very important economically, but main thing was like, they wanted to have a big force who could not speak Hindi to control India, because it was not possible to bring British citizens to India. They don't want to sacrifice their blood in this, according to them, a very hot, bloody desert place. So who they would be the good people for the Gurkhas, they didn't speak Hindi. So they wanted to drain the people in army, so they will therefore stop reorganizing youth and fight against British again, and they could also protect colony, was the very very important thing. I think you already read the statistics, okay? So I don't have to discuss about it. Like many fronts, they died. But what is my hypothesis is that had not Napoleon attacked in Russia in 1812, Waterloo would not be made by Britain. And had not Waterloo War, in which France was defeated, Nepal would not be losing its part of country. So see, actually Nepal's loss of territory first started in 1812 in Borodino in Russia. Because Napoleon exhausted most people in Russian war. Coming back, there was a war with British. It had very young people and very small number of army to fight with British, and British slaughtered them. So when British slaughtered French, then there was no another competitor to the British, so immediately they attacked in Nepal. They planned to attack even before, but they didn't dare. But after they defeated Nepal. One very interesting phenomenon what we see is like, some of the French soldiers already were here secretly, and today's Nepalese, a lot of insignia and other has a legacy with the French army, because they taught Nepalese soldiers that time. Now, the first of those called Gurkhas were called from the Nepalese prisoners of war. So war was still going, it is very interesting, you know. War was still going in. Bhakti Thapa was fighting, Amar Singh Thapa was fighting. But a guy called Yong, Lieutenant Yong, started collecting these people who were made prisoners of war, and he started instilling Gurkha again. So in 16, still there was some sporadic events of war, but already Gurkha Brigade was there. So you can see it here. British did not have intention of taking entire Nepal. This is a wrong statement of some historians. They changed the mind. They wanted to capture Nepal, but they changed the mind. Main would be important than rugged territory. What to do with this on inaccessible mountain? So they thought that these people are important. Okay, Anglo-Rana Alliance was developed with the sea idea of Nepalese youths to perpetuate colonial rule. Large number of prisoners of war came from Kumaon and Garhwal. The first battalion was called Seymour Battalion, subsequently called 2nd King Edward 7th Rifle. Governor Moria sanctioned the formation of Seymour Battalion on 24th April 2005, still war was going on. So when British sanctioned to creation of Gurkha Brigade? When we were having war. So this is very interesting. There was war is still going on. Lieutenant Yong was commissioned to construct Seymour Battalion. He was killed in Kalanga. He was killed by Bhakti Thapa. It is why Yong is called the father of the Gurkha Brigade. Okay. Second to Seymour was Nasir Battalion at Simla and Kumaon Battalion at Almora. Two more brigades were created. Malao Battalion was added in Punjab in 1916, still we had not completely adjusted the relation with British. Fatehpur Levy, Katak Legion, Shalat Battalion, Assam Seaborn Division Corps, Extra Gurkha Regiment and Hazara Battalion were created later. Already by 1920, 30,000 youths had been illegally recruited in Gurkha Brigade. So with 8.6 population, million, less than 1 crore population, you can see. Figures. Let me give you some figures. No accurate figures of men recruited in the Gurkha Brigade before 1870 is available. In 1870, the number of Gurkha soldiers was a smaller age, 4,685 men. The true figure was kept secret as Rana didn't like or didn't permit recruitment until that time. In 1895, when Jung Bahadur was annihilated, and the number was shown 7,000. It is said it diametrically increased when Rana, Prime Minister B. Samsara, officially lifted the ban on recruitment in 1885, and recruitment was released and declared openly. So after that, the number was declared. Prime Minister Chandrashamsher Rana dispatched a contingent of 24,469 men for the First World War. Another contingent of 5,500 men was dispatched again during active war period. These figures, however, do not include men who were directly recruited by British deports in India. So total 230,000 people were used in First World War. Let me tell you two stories. There were 12,000 Gurkhas in Mandalay. They were just brought from Calcutta and they were still acclimatizing with the weather of Burma. Japanese had taken over the mountain part. Gurkhas still didn't know which part of the world they were. So they were still, briefing was not done. There was all of sudden bombings by the British, by the Japanese. So these 12,000 people started running to the Mandalay River. But Mandalay River bridge was already broken. It was destroyed by the Japanese. So there was only way for them to save their life was everybody to jump into that river. And this river was a big river and full of crocodiles. So 12,000 people jumped into this river. And Japanese knew that there was no other options to go. So they already had fixed their cannon to fire on the water. So they kept firing almost by 20 cannons in the water. All these 12,000 people in the rivers were annihilated. Only 360 people saved and crossed the other side. So that is how a story is written by a Gurkha that the river had completely gone red for a couple of hours. And the people were being eaten by the crocodiles in a way, like more than 12,000 crocodiles were fighting to eat Gurkhas. That history is still disappearing. Our historians have done a big, big, big injustice to this country. Another big episode that you can think about and do research is told by a man who was there in the fighting. In evening, British gave them this very strong rum that was given to horses actually. So all Gurkhas were made to drink this rum and they were asked to go up to the hill the night there to fight with the Japanese. So Japanese had taken over the hill and they were most in the high hills. Next morning, exhausted, they came and Japanese started firing up from up. So almost 7,000 people were killed in one. And that time, Chandrashamsher's son was a legion officer. So he visited next day over there. There was one man, because of the bomb, it fell very close to him. He didn't die, but his two eyes came out. Okay, so he was still living. So when Chandrashamsher's son saw that a man with his eyeballs out hanging, but is still not dead, and then he became painted over there. So this is a story written by a guy called Khawas, who has written a biography of that war. So it's almost 15,000 people died in Gurkha, in Burma. So then British had to lift people from Assam to Burma again. But that time there were no that big airlines to fetch people from one place to another. So that was a 24-seater something called Pokhar or another. So what they did was like they built big wooden box and they hanged in the airlines, and 20 inside and 20 in that big cage like we keep in Tiger. Many of them on the way, they were smashed and then they fall down. Okay, so this is a terrible, I mean, you can read a journal if you sometime have a time. I have in my library called Shainik Awaz Special. So in that journal, these all descriptions are fully given. So this is what I think. Post Second World War, I don't have to go much. In 1947 February, British were uncertain as to what to do with the brigade. Okay, this came a very difficult time. India is going to be independent, and then very important thing was like what to do with this. Okay, so couple of things are very interesting that if you read this article, you will find. Not having much time, and also I would like to just give you some very important incidents, and I'm finishing. F.J. Ballinger's letter to Lord Pathetic Lawrence at cost is high. Okay, he said that maintaining Gurkhas, the cost is very high. It was the letter. Negotiation was pending for a long time. Secret diplomacy began soon. On 11 March 1947, a communication was dispatched to India, and it said that wait for a few weeks, the communication is coming. Creating an agriculture force out of Gurkhas, April 15, 1947, letter to Tom William, agriculture minister, from Bishop of Second Gurkhas. Okay, let me give you this very interesting information. What is actually very nice. Okay, Gurkhas served to the British. They died for the British sovereignty. But what was the treatment of Gurkhas? First, they want to disband it, or they want to deposit it, or left it to Indians. But before they declared that Gurkhas should be let to India, they tried their best how they can make use of it. Sure, this letter says that in view of the, I will let me 5 minutes, 10 minutes, okay. In view of the present and prospective shortage of labor in the agriculture industry in this country, this letter is sent by Bishop of Second Gurkha Regiment to Agriculture Minister of Britain that time. In the agriculture industry in this country, UK, I venture to lay before you for consideration proposal which I think deserves careful and sympathetic examination. This is the later excerpts. During the war, I have had privilege of serving for some three years with Gurkha troops, and I claim to know them well. The Gurkha is hard worker, always willing and cheerful, has been brought up in peasant surrounding, and is by nature an agriculturist. And by tradition loves the British. This is a great wealth of labor in Nepal. For which in the past natural outlets had been service in the Indian Army under British officers. This outlet must, if necessary, be circumscribed, if not entirely, stopped in coming years. And there is already a feeling that British, who have been magnificently served by Gurkhas in times past, are going to let them down. When change comes in India, I am quite certain that if Gurkhas were invited under suitable conditions, what are the suitable conditions? I will tell you, to do agricultural work in Great Britain, they could be recruited in large number, and to our mutual advantage, the following point arises. One, why they should be serving as agricultural labor? Well, it would ease negotiation with Nepal government if the Gurkhas were recruited on a military basis in agricultural battalions for a definite form terms overseas, say it's 2 years. So they will give them food another 2 years. Two, feeding would present no difficulty. What no makes difficulty? Feeding. Why feeding is not difficult for Nepalese? We are very special people. What British understand about us. They said that rice would be necessary for Gurkhas cannot eat beef and they survive with rice and lentil. How cheap is the food that Nepalese eat? Therefore, they should be brought in Britain. Third, they would prefer to work for their keep only. They work not to earn. Why they work for? Only to keep them, to survive. So what was the salary proposed by the guy is like, but they should be paid lump sum on completion of terms 2 years, 1,000. That is £77 per annum. Okay? And they will go happy back to home. Third, they would prefer, fourth, climate presents no difficulty. They are hardy hillmen. Okay? Fifth, accommodation Gurkha are used to build their own houses. And therefore, where camps are not already available, they would provide for themselves with the minimum of materials. They are well disciplined and would cause no trouble if billeted in farms or if outhouses, barns, and cottages. Camp supervisor could be found amongst demobilized British officials who have served in Gurkha regiment. It might necessary to bring a few religious teachers from Nepal. That's all. So that was the proposal. What happened? This is what the biggest pain that British has given to Gurkha. But unfortunately, unfortunately, war began in Malaysia in 1952. So this all thing had to be stopped. Otherwise, they would be working in British farms as agricultural workers, Gurkha. But since war started, everybody was switched to Malaysia again. So today, these people still live. We call them Lauri. They cannot survive without 2 bottles of beer in the evening because this is how they have been educated. What they speak, nobody understands because they didn't properly understood the English word. So they have transcribed those words into their own language. So when they see white men, I mean, if it looks a little bit like army men, then they salute. But they feel that they are Nepalese. And they still largely believe that they served the British not because of the money, because £77 was not enough. But they still believe that it is because our government had good relation with British to help the government. They were loyal citizens, therefore the government said that go and serve the British. So without asking any question, they went and served British. So they were not serving British, they were serving Nepalese. Unfortunately, this moment has been terrible. All politicians have, as I said, did injustice. When Krishna Prasad Bhattrai was the Prime Minister second time, after a lot of discussion, a kind of agreement was reached, and there were a lot of Gurkhas in Pokhara, Narayanghat, and many places were in a jubilation buying beer and drinking beer that time. Because next day the British House of Commons was going to announce £324 pension equal to Gurkhas. But then there was a man who was called Deepak Guru, was a major British major, but was a Nepali Congress member then. So he called Krishna Prasad Bhattrai and said that if these people get £324, it is 6 or 7 times larger to the Nepalese commander-in-chief, so it would be a big injustice to the Nepalese soldiers. So he said that you should cut down it. So Bhattrai called ambassador and not to make that, so again it was last. So that's how. General like Sharma should discuss with me. Because they work over there, so if their salary, it's not a question of rank, it's a hard thing. So Nepalese military should not think that if they get a little bit more money, then it is a downing of the position of Nepalese military. Rather, if Nepal military really becomes a very good institution in Nepal, they should invite these people and give this insignificant. Okay, if there is a British captain, why not recognize him as captain? Why don't, I am sure and damn sure that these people are quite skillful people. They know engineering, they can build bridges, they can build roads. Okay, they're perfectly skilled. I think if Nepal army brings them as an experts, to work for this kind of roads and other, I think they would be the biggest asset for Nepalese military. Sure, I think all of us, government, Nepal military, and everyone, is a duty to support these people and get a justice of equality. So this is my fight. I would like to stop at this point because I said you that where to start and where to end, I don't know. Okay. If you have some question, I will be happy. But every Nepalese has responsibility to defend them, and we have to fight for this. Because if we leave injustice inside, we cannot talk of justice somewhere else. Sure. But NGOs never supported this. I tried my best that time to engage NGOs, but they never came because most NGOs have been funded by the Western countries, so they don't want to work for it. So that is another big problem. So with this, I would like to end here. Thank you very much.